28 much needed social apartments. There's also brownfield, and if we're going to avoid developing green belt, these are exactly the sorts of stuff that need to be developed. I think it's worth pointing out that this building attracts a grant from Homes England. Now, when people send talk about the scale and the scale of the development, I think you just need to know what the context. Caveness Gardens next door, there's also a four-storey, I'm assuming 1950s design, place nets, and on the other side of the area, there were our mall gardens, that's similar. It's all right, but it's just a bit of a full support.
Thank you, Tom.
I would just like to say, I think I appreciate the point that you made around the continuity. There are flats there, it follows, you walk the road up, it does follow the road of flats. But when you look at the area, it is an open space, and it is an open space that breaks up the flow of flats. And it is an open space within the heart of the community that is deliberately open. There's a park there, there's an open walkway. So I do think the point on the change in street scene still stands, despite there being other similar flats in the area.
Thanks, sure. Shall I bring Steve back in just to put the proposed reasons?
Yeah, I agree with what you say, actually. I think streets seem to be an important issue. So I'll do my wording and then you can start for yourself. The proposed development, by virtue of its excessive scale, mass and bulk, would appear dominant and out of context with the character of this part of Prenton Hall Road, and would introduce an incongruous form of development into the area that would dominate and detract from street scene. As such, the proposal will be contrary to policy HS4 Part 1 and 2 and the principles of the National Planning Policy Framework.
Okay,
is
that seconded? Any more contributions from the floor? No. I think what's been said in terms of this being an incredibly finely balanced application is correct. There are lots of boxes ticked on affordable housing, levels of brownfield sites, etc. Steve mentions HS4, and we bring to our attention two paragraphs. Paragraph one, as he mentions, specifically says the proposal must be of a scale which relates well to surrounding property, in particular with regard to existing densities and form of development, and two, talks about a detrimental change in the character of the area. These are very clearly subjective matters, and it's a matter of what's it like to break the deadlock. That's what people think. I do agree with what members have said about not designing something on the hoof. We can only determine an application that's before us and how it looks. Now, when I look at it, at the site plan, I do see Goldsmith Way framed, in my view, by the mill shops to the south, where the coals and the Chinese kitchen are. It seems to be set at an angle that seems to frame that whole area at a time when planners obviously saw the public house as being the centre of the community, which has been referred to, and also the play area. And then to the very north of this, if you like, piece of space, we have the community facilities, the library, post office, etc. So clearly, whoever designed this originally, back in the whenever, had in mind that this would be the focal point, the centre of the Prenton community. It was framed in such a way. Seems quite right, you know, making pubs viable these days is an incredibly difficult thing. And we may lament it, some may lament it more than others. Nevertheless, we are where we are. I do think, from my own perspective, that the form, as referred to in HS4, of flat roofed four-storey, it's not the four-storey's objective, because the built form in the general area is all four-storey. But the flat roof and the general mass of it, in my view, is adding to the surrounding flats, which are all set at an angle and set back from the street. In terms of traffic, highways have not raised any objections to traffic movements. But again, we can see what the planners in the area had in mind when they made all the roads around the central very narrow. They weren't encouraging traffic movements, they were encouraging community use. The existing Davenport has two entrances to one close to its junction at Prenton Hall Road. And indeed, that's the entrance that we used when we went on our site visit to see it. That entrance would be lost, and all cars, all vehicles visiting the site would have to enter, if you like, the narrow area. I don't believe that would result in highway danger as such, but probably issues of congestion would become an issue. I think we've rehearsed all of the arguments for and against. We have a proposal duly seconded to refuse it on the grounds of non-compliance with HS for paragraphs 1 and 2. Can I see those in favour of that refusal, please? See those against? Okay, that refusal lost, 10 votes to 4. Can I hear a resolution for approval?
Before I move that here, in the sort of sense of what we've been hearing tonight, I do vote, whatever the vote is, I won't be able to vote that the association involved with the application does engage on an ongoing basis, and perhaps you hear some of the rules that are seeing that. That would just be a comment to make.
I'm sure that's been heard from the floor. Can I have a proposal?
I'll second it.
Okay, see if that's move approval. Stuart to second. Can you see those in favour of approval, please? And those against. Members of public and those present for this application on the download have been approved. 10 votes to 4. We move on now, please, to agenda item 11. Agenda item 11 deals with Westways 60 Lingdale Road, Westclare. There is no qualified petition on our agenda. I take note of delegation by Councillor Knox, who is about to address us. If the officer could give their presentation.
Chair, can I just before we get going, can I pass these down to the officer, please? I'd just like some clarification on something that might help before we get going. It's with regards to the actual site itself. There's two site plans shown, and it will actually alter what I'm going to say, whether you can confirm which one is the actual plan that is submitted within this application.
So this application seeks permission for changes to the rear extension of this development that has already had planning permission. These changes include a small increase in the footprint and the height of the approved extension, and a change from a flat roof over the glazed link extension between the main building and the extension to a pitched roof. Many of the objections raised to this application seek to revisit the objections that were made when the development was approved in 2017. This application does not seek permission for the development as a whole, as permission has already been granted and implemented. This includes the extension that has been built at the rear of the existing property, which has been converted into apartments. This application seeks permission solely for the small changes in the footprint and height of the development that have occurred since the building works commenced. The height of the building has increased by 20 centimetres. The width of the building has increased by 40 centimetres. The depth of the building has been increased by 50 centimetres. This has resulted in a small increase in the footprint of the building by 4.6 metres. The roof of the glazed link between the extension and the existing building has also been changed from a flat roof to a pitched roof. The objections that have been raised relate to the architectural merits of the development, the scale and design of the development, whether it is out of character with the area and main dwelling. These objections were raised in 2017 when the development was granted planning permission, and all members are being asked to consider this evening on the small increases that have occurred during the building work. The building is at the rear of the site and cannot be viewed from Lingdale Road. When viewed outside of the site boundaries, the changes that have resulted are so minimal that they would be negligible and do not result in any additional issues in relation to loss of privacy or scale or overbearance. Were these small increases to be refused, members should understand that the substantive scale of the extension would remain as this has been granted planning permission and that permission has been implemented. There is no petition in connection with this application.
So if you could introduce yourself and
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Committee, for hearing my submission this evening. My name is Councillor Sammy Cox. I'm the Hoylake Mells Ward Councillor, which encompasses quite a bit of West Kirby, as it happens. I'll start by saying I'd like to take exception to what Mr. Paddy Davies has actually said there. He used the words small or little or minuscule or whatever, as many times as he possibly could within those opening statements. The reason this has actually come before Planning Committee is because it was noted by one of the residents who are adjacent to this development that it was larger than what they'd actually been planning. And what actually took place was an enforcement officer went out to ensure that it was larger. It was confirmed that it was larger. And I asked for it to come back to planning, which is exactly what's taking place now. So it sounded like it was trying to be diminished before we even got going in the debate. And I take exception to that. I think what we're talking about here is it's a question of what is acceptable and what is reasonable for developers to do to residents, but also what is acceptable to do in a conservation area. This development is clearly an eyesore for anyone who's actually seen it and anyone who participated in the site visit. It's a blot on the landscape. I think it is so out of keeping with surrounding properties as to be absurd. The development of the existing property, which was already there, which is an arts and crafts property, is all well and good, and I think all residents are very happy with that. But what can only be described as a clinical, rectangular box-like structure has been bolted into the back of the property. It provides zero architectural enrichment to what is, as I've just alluded to, a conservation area. It is also visible from the roads, which is contrary to the officer guidance just given. There is no doubt that this structure is diminishing my residents' right to light, but it is also so overbearing as to be ludicrously intrusive. There is a window, and yes, it may be all well and good that it is frosted, but it looks directly onto one of the neighbours' patios. And I'm not talking about from 40 or 50 yards away here, we're talking 3 metres, where there's previously there was nothing overlooking their patio. This is, without a doubt, a loss of privacy. Then there's the fact that planning was sought for this application. This is actually what took place previously. And granted, the developer went away and constructed a box that is longer, wider, and most importantly, in my mind, when thinking about the overbearing nature of this development, it is higher than what was granted. There are also windows that are larger than were previously approved. I've got to make a point to ask, what is the point of planning and building control when actually we have control of nothing? If we continually allow other developments and developers to do as they please, we render this committee and the council impotent if we do not react to this evening. So to sum up, the property is extremely overbearing and impedes upon residents' privacy. It directly affects residents' right to light. It had numerous objections, even though there was no petition, 16 at last count on the internet. It has been objected against by the local conservation group. It is completely out of keeping, and owing to the information I just received there, there are two plans actually submitted on the internet. One is showing the land that is owned by the developer. Did I say it was used to muddy the waters? It was initially shown in March as looking like the development encompassed all of the land, as to indicate that it was not over development, which has then subsequently been reduced. So I would argue it is, owing to this, over development as well. And I believe it's also an infringement on the Wirral Unity Development Plan, in particular, CH2 11.8. Thank you.
Thank you. Any members have questions for Sir?
Thank you, Chair. What is your objection here tonight, given that we've been told the planning itself has already been granted? So,
that's a reasonable question, Paul. The way that you just used planning has already been granted. It hasn't. Planning has already been granted for something that is substantially smaller in square meters than what the item that's actually being developed. And at what point do the committee say that enforcement needs to take place? Is it another 50 centimetres? Is it another 60 centimetres? At some point, we have to say, we've given the benefits of the doubt to the developer, we've given them planning permission, they've gone away and done whatever they want, and this isn't the only people who do it. I know we're looking at this specific application this evening. At some point, we have to say, no, you've taken the mick and you've overstepped the boundaries. And I believe that at worst, it should be taken back to exactly what we gave them last time. Worst case scenario. I would also like, if I can with the chair's permission, when we come to sum it up, if it looks, and I genuinely hope it isn't looked down upon this particular application, it isn't passed, but if it is, I'd like to look at some conditions anyway, we can, at the end, which I've not highlighted yet, should it really look at that. But at the very least, I think we should be looking at making double what they were actually given plan for in the first instance.
I'm afraid there isn't an opportunity to, for people making presentations to us to take part in the debate. So we're not going to be able to pick that up from you.
Just while you're here, Tony, you did effectively challenge the professional integrity of our planning officer.
I didn't question the words you used.
Saying the over-exaggerated, those terms that the officer, because officers have difficulty defending themselves, for obvious reasons, those terms are quite often heard at the planning committee in terms of minimal and so on and so forth. So I just, if you didn't mean to offend his integrity, then you have the choice to apologise.
Well, I think there's two things to that. I think it's going to be a matter of force as to whether we think the measurements that we've been presented with are significant. Second issue, I think, raises one of enforcement. The issue of enforcement doesn't arise because of there's an application that we've not yet determined. Once we've determined it, that issue may or may not become valid. But at the moment, there's no issue of enforcement because when officers went to the sites, the applicant acted by putting a fresh planning application to make good, or like the just for that.
Chairman, I can't, but if seeing Steve's acting as a bodyguard for officers, I will apologise if Mr. Paddy Davies took any offence to my comments. But on the same score, I'm entitled to take offence to the comments that were actually used, I think, if I see. The terminology that was used, I believe, was inappropriate, so I'm entitled to actually take offence.
Okay. Are there any further questions from council?
Obviously, as fellow councillor, I do have the answer, but I think it's all of the committee understand.
to the front of the property is where they suggest that they are arts and crafts, on the whole arts and crafts, 1900s properties, with this bolt on. There to the rear of the property is the vulnerable golf course. So we whilst allowing a development within a conservation area, which in my opinion is only appropriate, it will be viewed by, I don't know, probably a billion people in a couple of years' time, and I'm sure they will have their take on it. I think it's a ridiculous development. And yes, we only are talking about directly the extension of it. And I'll go again and say again and reiterate, at what point would we say this is over development? At what point would we say liberties have been taken by the developer?
Is this a question?
Yes,
we'll be able to for a while if it's a point that we can make in committee, because one of the questions there was supposed to be clarification on what's been said. But I think we've probably concluded that part and can move on to a debate in committee. Is that it? So thank you very much for your
architects and go through all the rationales and come to a decision as to what size and shape and height an extension is going to be. So I wonder what the rationale was for the applicant to exceed the measurements that were given and to go a little bigger. If it's not much more than it was originally, I would wonder why the applicant didn't in the first instance put an application for that size. I'm wondering whether or not if the application gone in and it was the size it is now, would it have been passed? And so the question I'm wondering is whether or not the application had been put in retrospectively and gone bigger than it should have been, because it's been passed in the first instance on X measurements, but had it come before the planning department offices when it was Y as it is now, would it have been passed? Because I think it's difficult for us here in the planning committee when we're looking at what seem to be minute differences. The objection says it's 25% bigger, and the detail that Matthew was giving do seem to be minimal in terms of 0.2 metres or 0.5 for most of us.
I think the short answer is in the recommendation to the committee. If we felt that these increases were not acceptable, then we wouldn't be bringing a recommendation to approve it to you, and we would be potentially looking to enforce the permission that was granted in 2017.
The site visit last week, and I must admit I don't recognise the comment in the report that people who are opposing the application now are saying it's 25% larger than the original, because I mean, we actually looked at the application from the front and the side and the back, and I do accept, I know Councillor Cox took exception to the words that Matthew used about there was a small increase in footprint, a small increase in the height, etc. But everything I looked at in detail did show to me that there were small increases. So I think to use phrases like, it's an eyesore and a blot on the landscape, and ludicrously intrusive. I went on a site visit and I didn't recognise that at all. I think now if there's not to approve this, I think it would be a nonsense. What were we actually saying? That the original application was wrong, or that the whole thing now needs to be knocked down and start again? I think that would be unreasonable. So I, for one, Chair, I'm happy to approve the recommendation on this application. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Chair. I think it's important in this application to understand that it doesn't happen by accident that you build something wider, longer and taller. So there's clearly been a deception somewhat in this whole process. And also, this is in a conservation area. And if you look at policy CH2 11.8, it's the immediate locality of the street scene for the path important views into and out of the area, into and out of. And I'll draw back to the Royal Liverpool and the open Gulf that is coming there. The whole of the world is about to see Wirral's planning policies in full view. There will be many hundreds and millions of people across the world that will see this. It's got zero architectural interest. So when we talk about, oh, it's only 0.2 by 0.4 or 0.2, it's only 4.2 metres. We've got to view that through the lens of this is a conservation area. So it's not just 4.5 metres bigger. The importance, the weighting we should give to that should be greatly increased. As in, it isn't just a straight line, and this is a house or a development somewhere in the breeze, but we'd love to. So I'd like to ask the question, if I can ask it, has this been considered within that lens of conservation area, front and back? And the view, and bear in mind that conservation area was largely designed to protect the Royal Liverpool. So it isn't about the street scene, it's about the view from the Royal Liverpool.
The recourse indicates the level of policies that the officers have consulted.
Thank you, through you, Chair. Yes, as Councillor Kelly says, in the report we have had regard to the relevant conservation area policies that are contained in the UDP. I think I would have to say that, you know, with any development, there may be what we call building tolerances, so that when you go out on site and you measure them, they may be slightly larger or slightly smaller than the measurements shown on the plan. The view that we took when this was brought to our attention through an enforcement complaint was that the changes were such that we couldn't deal with them as what we called non-material. We felt that they were material to the application, and that was approved in 2017, and so that's why a new application has been submitted. Having said that, though, we feel that the increases are such that they don't impact on the overall feel and character of what was approved in 2017.
You may wish to make that. You wish whether there's any points that can be given to it, I guess will be a matter of each individual case.
That's just the points have been raised twice in terms of its potential background. So I think it's important just to understand. Thank you.
Size has gone over the original plans. Does it equate to 25%? so this blot on the landscape would still exist. And how was this brought to the attention of planning that this
So a complaint was made and we went out on site and took measurements, as I explained to Councillor Gardner. We felt that the increases were not such that they could be dealt with as a non-zero amendment, a new commission needed to be granted. The application was before the committee because Councillor Cox asked for it to be brought to committee and not to zoning on delegated powers.
So Jack, has any explanation been sought from the developer or the owner as to how this happened?
Yes, we've had those discussions with the owners of the site and those members who were present at the site visit on Friday as well. That was explained to members that there was an issue with the builder when the permission was implemented.
I would say there's a particular consideration. So this isn't just another part of the world, this is a conservation area. The planning policy, CH2.11.10, states views into or out of the area, which because of their nature, or scale, have a direct effect on the character of the designating zone. So we have something that isn't in character, and we've made it bigger than the original proposal. I think that is more than, that counts as a higher weighting than just it's a little bit bigger. So,
through you, Chair, is some of the formal basis for refusal of that or permission to
move? No one's offered yes, but that means that the
Can I ask a question of the planning officer? In the planning history on this particular site, there is a reference to an application that was made 3 or 4 years ago. It was a retrospective application of constructing a raised observation deck, and that was refused. What's the difference between the two applications, between the one before us tonight and the one that was refused 3 or 4 years ago?
The application for the raised deck was a separate structure that was right at the back of the that was at the back of the site. And if I can recall it correctly, forgive me if I'm wrong, but I think it was erected around the time of the open, so that it could be so that the golf could be viewed. But in essence, we felt that structure did have a detrimental impact on the character of the conservation area because it essentially looked like a railway bridge with a park bench on top of it. So it wasn't a very pleasant structure. So that's the difference between this one and that.
Thank you.
Okay, has anybody finished the contribution? Stephen?
No one's moved any reason for refusing. Can I? So I will move refusal. If I could remove.
Yes, of course.
We refuse all the development is contrary to policy CH2.11.8 of the Unitary Development Plan and contravention of the principles of the MPDF. In particular, it is dominant and out of character with neighbouring properties which are within a conservation area. It is also further variance of adjacent properties impeding on the rights of light and removing residents' rights to privacy.
Thank you.
Do
you have a second then? Well, yes, we've heard arguments about what we should be weighing in the balance and whether we think that we've had the dimensions read to us, so they took for clarity, maybe I'll read them again. The increase in height, sort of 20 centimetres, in depth, 53 centimetres, and in width, 40 centimetres, I guess. It's for us to decide whether that sort of increase is significant and whether, from the point of view of people watching on television, they will be able to discern on a television screen, even with, that increase had taken place. I'm bound to say, been granted plan permission in its implement. My guess is if it had come to committee, we would have had an entertaining discussion about it. May not, though it's hard to prejudge what a previous committee would have done, may not have given this approval. The question for us is whether those dimensions add extra harm to the to the dwelling that's there. And I'm afraid I'm not personally convinced that it does. Nonetheless, we have a motion for refusal, which is seconded. Can I see those in favour of refusal? Are those against you? Refusal has been lost. Votes 2-3. I'll move approval from the chair.
I'll second
that. Seconded by Councillor Kemp. Can see those in favour of approval. Those against. Thank you. For those members of the public here for the application. At 16 Lingdale, that application has been approved, and votes 2-3. Now we move on to agenda item number 5, which is 1 Oldfield Drive, Heswall. And there is a profile petition, but I'll ask to introduce the item.
Okay, so planning permission is sought for the erection of 5 apartments with associated parking and landscaping works. The application will involve the demolition of the existing bungalow on site, and the site is located at the junction of Oldfield Road and Telegraph Road and is located within the primarily residential area. The proposals provide for 4 2-bed apartments on the ground and first floor, with 1 3-bed apartment on the second floor, which will be contained within the roof space. The apartment block has been designed to appear as a large single dwelling. The new building would be 8.7 metres high to the ridge and would measure 13.8 metres deep and 15.4 metres wide. There would be 8 metres between the new build and the adjacent property on Oldfield Drive, with a similar distance between the new build and 295 Telegraph Road to the south of the site. There are no habitable room windows that would be affected by the proposed development. The proposals would not result in any significant overshadowing of the adjacent properties. Access would be from Oldfield Drive, and 10 off-road parking spaces are provided at a ratio of 2 spaces per apartment. The bin store and cycle store are also provided within the site. There is a qualified petition of objection.
The petitioner would like to come forward and address.
I don't wish to speak, Chair.
Thank you. That being the case, some of the current customary practice, the applicant may not address it either. Does the Ward Councillor wish to address it?
Good evening.
You will need to introduce yourself.
Councillor Andrew Hodson, Gate and Hesswall Ward. Thank you, Chair. Local people appreciated the site visit, which the committee made last week. I understand there were questions about the height of the proposed building and its impact on its neighbour, 295 Telegraph Road. The report to committee confirms that the ridge height is 8.6 metres. This would be about 1.7 metres for the ridge height of number 295. It suggested that the distances between the buildings was compliant, but the impact on the amenity garden area is not an issue. In fact, the committee report does raise this aspect of the development, and it must therefore be an issue, and I invite members to form the view that the proposed development would be overbearing. Local people appreciate that it was impractical for the committee to walk down Telegraph Road to the 2 existing blocks of flats and 1 under construction, which are referred to in the case officer's report. However, I would point out that the nearest of these is some 350 metres away, 350 metres closer to Heswall Centre than 1 Oldfield Drive. And I don't agree with the statements in paragraph 3.87 of the report, which concludes that because these Telegraph Road flats were approved so the scheme for one Oldfield Drive would be appropriate. It is a very different character area, and unlike those on Telegraph Roads, it is not within the required distance of public transport. I am concerned that the approval of this application is an invitation to a cumulative high-density flat development along Telegraph Road and onto Oldfield Drive. And the report to the committee suggests that this application, which has a density equivalent to 45 dwellings per hectare, does need to be judged against the SPD2 clauses governing high-density development. Whether that is right or wrong, at the very least, the scheme should be judged against the clauses which apply to all flat developments. And I have circulated a copy of the relevant part of the Wirral Council for SPD2 in which I've highlighted those sections which refer to requirements for all flats. SPD2 paragraph 3.1 states that all developments for self-controlled flats should be in locations that are close to services and facilities and that are generally accessible by choosing means of transport. In paragraph 3.4 it returns to the requirements of all flats. It says that all sites for self-contained flats should be accessible by good transport links to and from main employment areas, schools, shops, health and leisure and entertainment facilities. Walking and cycling are the most sustainable forms of transport, but proximity to main bus routes and railway stations is important if public transport is to be a viable option for motor car for long journeys. It states public transport will only be considered as a feasible alternative if there is a regular service to a range of destinations, and sites for self-contained flats should therefore also be within the 400 metres safe and convenient walking distance of a bus stop, with regular service with a frequency of 20 minutes or within 400 metres of a railway station that provides a regular service. The application site lies in a very limited residential area, and the nearest bus stops are at the junction of Telegraph Road, well in excess of 400 metres from the development. Paragraph 3.11.2 of the committee report, the case officer writes, whilst it may not be within 400 metres safe walking distance of a bus stop, the proposed scheme is providing a sufficient number of vehicle and parking spaces, and the current application is clearly not compliant with SPD2 in relation to the general location of flat developments and excuse this on the basis that as adequate parking is certainly not compatible with a client's emergency approach. UDP policy HS4 brackets I requires proposals to be on a scale which relates well to surrounding property in particular with regard to existing densities and forms of development. And the density and form of development proposed is in conflict with the requirements of powers 3.1 and 3.4 of the SPD2. In addition, it would not be on a scale which would relate well to its neighbour. So, if the council's land use guidance is ignored, if a systematic and rules-based approach is set aside, it opens up any area in the world to flat development. It was to avoid this supplementary planning document. It was to avoid this that the supplementary planning document was adopted, and it asked the committee to refuse to